Bob and Penny Lord, and we invite you to join us in the jungles of Tequila, Mexico, as we share with you the life of one of our blessed martyrs of Mexico, Blessed Toribio Romo. Toribio Romo was born on the Santa Ana Ranch in Guadalupe, Mexico, in the state of Jalisco on April 15, 1900. He was baptized the next day and received First Holy Communion at the age of 7. At 13 years old, he began his studies at the Minor Seminary of San Juan de los Lagos. He received minor vows on February 19th, and he consecrated himself to the Sacred Heart of Jesus, Our Lady of Guadalupe, and Saint Joseph. He was ordained deacon on September the 3rd, 1922, and on the 23rd of December of the same year, ordained priest by his local bishop. He celebrated his first Mass at his parish church at the age of 22. He was transferred to Coquillo, but religious persecution had begun, and he found himself, along with Father Justino Orona and his associate Father Atilano Cruz, living a nomad's life.
I was also involved in the transfer of Father Atilano Cruz and Father Toribio Romo.
Father Toribio Romo was also assigned to this church, and Father Atilano Cruz took his place when he left. Jose was instrumental in bringing Father Romo over to this ranch and bringing Father Cruz back. So he knew all of them, and I believe he said he was an altar boy for Father Romo when he was here at the church.
Maybe could he tell us a little bit about Father Romo, who's very dear to our hearts?
He had a light complexion, straight hair, very much dedicated to the service of his people. He married me.
Oh. Is that right? Oh, that's beautiful.
When Father Atilano came here, Father Romo went to Tequila.
How did you feel, Jose, when Father Romo was transferred, especially to a church where, to a parish where it was a death sentence? How did you feel when that beautiful young priest was transferred?
I felt like I lost him, because there would be a great distance between us. He was a very good friend and a fine priest. I went to take him personally. I was devastated. We hugged and said goodbye. Father Atilano went with him. Then I wasn't so worried because the soldiers didn't know Father Romo. They will not be able to recognize him as a priest. He was only here for 9 months. As Father Romo said goodbye, he told me that we will see each other again sooner or later. He said not to worry. Someday we will meet again and see each other again. But it wasn't so.
We're here with Father Julio Torres and Martin Landero. Father Julio is the pastor of the church today in Tequila, Mexico, where Father Romo had his ministry, and Martin Landero knew Father Romo before he was killed.
We've come up a very hard and arduous road, just an unbelievable road that very few cars can come up. And as we came, we could see the dense forests and jungles beneath. And this was his parish. When he had to come and hide in the brush, he'd go down through all this thick to minister to his people. And he ministered all the sacraments. He taught all the children and the adults catechism. The church was his life. He was young, but every hour of his life was dedicated to serving his Lord through his church.
And because it was so thick, because it was so dense as it is, he was able to elude the authorities, the civil authorities and the government troops. You've got to remember that when he came here to Tequila, he came to a parish that no priest wanted to come to because it was a death warrant. When you came here, you knew you were going to die because both the civil authorities and the military hated the priests here. This is what this young 26-year-old priest walked into.
And he didn't want to, but he obeyed. And so when he obeyed, he knew that he started his way of the cross. We'd like to ask our brother, our beautiful brother, so typical of the people that live in the adobes here, the way they lived when Father Roma lived. We'd like to ask him if he remembers anything of Father. What kind of a priest was he?
He was a tall and slim man with fair complexion and a beard, because in those days they could not shave as they were hiding from the persecution. He was dressed as a charro, a cowboy, as part of his disguise. As soon as he arrived here, my father asked me to assist Father Romo at Mass. Father Romo taught me to be an altar boy.
How old were you when Father Roma taught you to be an altar boy?
I was 12 years old.
Were you here? Did you see the soldiers come and kill Father Roma?
On the day before his death, he asked me to assist him at the early Mass the next morning. I got up very early that morning, but my father told me to wait, since Father Romo had had very little sleep that night as he was preparing some papers that had to be sent to Guadalajara. My father took the papers and left for Guadalajara. On his way, he was stopped by the federal troops. They made him get off the horse as they were planning to hang him, but his friend, who was his guide, saved him. The day before this happened, Father Romo's brother, Father Roman Romo, went to Guadalajara. Otherwise, he would have been killed as well.
Father Roma was sleeping, and there were little huts around here. These huts belonged to the people who owned the house here. And Father was sleeping. That morning, this man was
this
a young boy, he was an altar boy, 12 years old, was supposed to come here early in the morning and celebrate Mass with Father.
Father had said to him, come early because I want to celebrate Mass early. And his father said to him, don't go because the priest has been up all night and he's sleeping, so let him sleep, you can go later.
If he had gone, he would have been killed with Father Roma and he wouldn't have been here to tell you the story. But when Father Roma was shot just a little ways down, he came to this spot, and that's where he died in his sister's arms. And this Martin, who lives right over here, heard the shots. Can you imagine that?
We interviewed a woman from this village who told us she was alive during the time when Father Toribio was killed. She said she saw his body being brought into one of the huts and laid out. The faithful from the parish, which he had lovingly served, filed past the body, paying their final respects at the risk of their lives. She showed us the photo that was taken of the martyr, Blessed Father Toribio, at that time.
Father, have the people always had a devotion to Father Roma, or has something happened, like we were just in a village where the tree that had been dead came to life after one of the martyrs was beatified? Has any change come about amongst these beautiful, simple people?
Naturally, I had the blessing of going to the beatification in Rome with a small group from Tequila. Devotion to him has been promoted. We have a picture of him, as he was one of the first pastors of this parish, and the people have a great devotion to him and have received many favors through his intercession, like healings of illnesses. Recently, pilgrims from Tepatitlán came here, since he was from that area. Five or six buses came on pilgrimage. He was a great catechist. We have taken him as our patron of catechists.
This is one of the priests that was beatified by His Holiness this last November, Mexican priest. And this is a statement he made on the day of his ordination. He said, "Oh, my brother, the Eucharist is to make one's heart beat. But that expression falls short of the mark. The heart skips a beat. The heart of the coldest priest explodes with the Eucharist. I believe that the Lord will give me a long life. After many years of ministry, aged by those many years, I would have no better remedy, nor the sharpest spur to keep me going, than to remember the day of my ordination and my first Mass, to reach the goal, to go up to the altar, to take bread for the first time and say, 'This is my body.'" This priest, who was ordained at 22 years old, was murdered at 28 years old.
You know what it's. You know what it looks like to me? It seems to me that the Lord has planted seeds, and the blood of the martyrs has nourished the land and nourished the people. And what has happened, instead of the focus to kill Christ and to kill all priests and all Catholics, it has grown, and the people have grown, and the faith has grown. Devotion to these martyrs. Now there are 25 martyrs scattered all over Mexico, and great devotion is beginning to all of them. It's uncanny. Only the Lord could do something like this.
Let the children come. Come. Bien, bien.
Niños, niños.
Niños. Guarda. Atención. Come here. Atención.
Niños. Niños.
Come here. Come here.
Come here.
Look.
Now, these were the people. Bien. These were the young bien. People.
Yeah.
That our priest ministered to as he went up and down through the thick, through the forests. These little people and the parents were the people that he would minister to here.
This is the hope of the church.
This is our church.
These little people, they're going to learn the faith because priests like this are going to carry on the work of Father Roma. Father comes here and celebrates Mass for these people at least once a month. We have a little school here. The children are taught as Jesus would teach them. These are the children that Jesus said, "Let the little children come unto me." These are the children that our Pope John Paul II is asking the world to help, to love, to protect. This is our church. Are they not beautiful? Who was Father Galvan? Who was Blessed Galvan? He was a boy born of very humble, simple people, hard-working people, and he lost his mother when he was yet a little boy. His father was a cobbler, a shoemaker. Father Galvan helped. He worked. He worked with his dad, and he went to minor seminary, preparing for the priesthood. And when he finished that Something happened to him, as happens to all of us. Let us say that the world tempted him. Suddenly,
the glamour of the world overcame him.
Yes, and so he didn't go on to the major seminary. He went to work. He knew the vocation as a cobbler, and so he went to work as a cobbler and as a school teacher as well. Now,
he drank too much.
Well, he was in the world. You know, I'm sure he didn't start out by drinking, but look at this world that is just crowding in, trying to drown out what we're saying about a martyr. Well, that's what happened with Father Galvan. The world was drowning out the word of God. Suddenly, materialism was great. He was earning money. Don't we know that feeling?
He had a girlfriend.
Ah, yes. I mean, he was good looking. He was very good looking. Can you imagine how he attracted the young girls? But he was a good boy. In spite of everything, he drank too much. He had a girlfriend, but he was a good young man.
Even though he was thrown into jail once for having beaten up his girlfriend because she was dancing with a Frenchman. So he had a temper as well. He was human. I mean, martyrs and saints are human beings who try harder. He was human.
Now, you know, we say, I think it was St. Augustine who said, talked about the hounds of heaven. And one day Brother Joseph said, boy, and have you ever seen the teeth on those dogs? I think that when God plants a thorn in your heart, that you can never get away from that feeling, that whisper in his heart of the priesthood. And so, after his foolish 3 years, he went back and he entered the major seminary. Now, that sounds wonderful, but his trials were not over. The testing was not over. He was going to, and we talk about that in our own ministry, he had to be toughened for the days ahead, and he was.
But he was committed. When he went back the second time, he was committed. The difference was in him. Every exterior was the same, the attacks were the same, only now he was strengthened, hardened against the attacks. He took on a new life, a new role.
Well, you know, another thing that he did, and sometimes we get so busy in doing things, I'm wondering, as a young boy, if he wasn't so busy fighting the battle of shouldn't I be a priest, that he got almost into here and thinking and using the mind. Suddenly, as he is in his young adulthood, remember, he's really been away from everything that he cherished. He knew, like Jesus knew, there was only one way. He knew there was only one way. And that was for that communication between himself and the Father.
Father Galván was very gifted intellectually and dedicated to his studies. He was simple, friendly, and always ready to lend a helping hand. Due to his intellectual capacity, from the very beginning of his priesthood, he was made a teacher and formation director of the Seminary of Guadalajara. There, he carried out his ministry for 6 years. But since the Seminary of Guadalajara was closed by the government, he was sent to a small town called Amatitán in Jalisco. He only stayed there for 3 months when he was taken prisoner.
We're on a city street in Guadalajara, Mexico. It was in this place that Father Galván was taken prisoner. If you can visualize, across the street was full of wounded. On the morning of January 30th, 1915, there had been a tremendous battle between the followers of Villa and the followers of Carranza. And there were many wounded, and Father Galván wanted desperately to tend to the wounded, to hear their confessions and give them absolution and the last rites of the church.
And when he expressed his desire, he was told, don't, it's dangerous. You have to remember that this was the beginning of the persecution. It was violent. And for a man to expose himself as a priest by hearing confessions, by giving last rites, was surely to be a death sentence. And Father Galvan said, what better way to die than to die saving a soul by giving them their last rites, by absolving them of their sins.
So he tried to get his pastor to go with him. He asked his pastor if he would go and hear the confessions of the wounded. He couldn't find his pastor. So he went and found Father Araiza, another priest, and the two of them came down here through this way on their bicycle, heading towards the church near the cathedral so they could tend to the wounded.
Now, part of the problem was that everyone, I mean, all the soldiers were ordered to pick up priests and to kill them, execute them. I mean, the sole reason for executing them was that they were priests. But in addition, there was a Colonel Vera who had been a classmate of Father's. And Father had prevented him from raping a young girl. The young girl refused to marry him because he was already married. And he forced himself on the girl. He was going to force her to marry him even though he was already married. And Father interceded. And Colonel Vera had this anger, this hatred towards him. And so imagine the joy that he had catching Father, the two priests, on the bicycle.
Well, when the troops caught Father, the two priests, and they brought them here, this was the municipal jail at the time, this is where Colonel Vera saw them. And if you could just imagine the delight in his face when he knew he was going to be able to have his revenge against his old classmate and enemy, Father Galvan, by executing him.
They were in this prison for 3 hours, and at one point, humanness of Father Araiza came up front, and he said to Father Galvan, we haven't had breakfast. I'm so hungry. And Father said, oh, don't worry. Soon we will be having breakfast with our Lord. Father had no fear of death. At one point he said to Father Araiza, Father, soon we will be judged by the Supreme Judge. Such faith, such faith. The angel of death was at his door and he knew it. And
he actually embraced martyrdom. Many, many of our Mexican martyrs actually embraced martyrdom. There's something very special about all these martyrs. And again, we talk about those that went through the seminary here in Guadalajara. They embraced the passion of Jesus. They took on the passion of Jesus on themselves, and they considered it a gift to be able to suffer martyrdom. Now, he was a human being. He had fears, we're sure of it, but he was able to overcome them. We talk about that signal grace that Mother Angelica tells us about, the grace to go beyond himself and to suffer this persecution, so that when he went into the room, into the courtyard rather, where the soldiers were standing there waiting for him, they were lined up, he stood there and looked at them and said, hit me here. They took them here to the back of the hospital, about 4 blocks away from Colonel Vera's quarters. And it was against this wall that he was executed. Father Araiza was not executed, but our priest was executed against this wall.
He stood in front of the men, and he piously crossed himself. And then he turned to them and said, shoot me here. They obliged him. Some of their shots were not very good. He received 3 mortal wounds. One of them in the neck, which was so the bullet was so explosive that it almost decapitated him. Just as he had been shot, some women ran up. They had been pleading for the release of the two priests. And Father Araiza was released, but not our Father Galvan, not our blessed martyr Galvan. And I don't think, even had she been able to to get the release if this Colonel Vera would have allowed him to escape. That's how angry he was.
The body was taken into the hospital behind here. This hospital was 200 years old, so the hospital was here at the time. The body of Father Galvan was taken to the hospital where the autopsy was done. Strangely enough, the chapel of this hospital is the chapel of Bethlehem, where our priest, our martyr, Sabas Reyes, celebrated his first mass 4 years after the death of Father Galvan. Father, since you've been here, you've been in this church for 8 years, how have you seen the devotion and prayers through the intercession of Blessed Galvan accelerate? Has it become a strong devotion to the Beata?
And has it affected the parish generally, the people?
Since 1915, when he was martyred, the parishioners have had a great veneration and love for Father Galvan. That devotion and love has not diminished at all, but on the contrary, it has grown tremendously. Many people come from different areas of the city and of the country to visit his tomb and ask for his intercession. Many have received favors through his intercession. Devotion to Father Galvan is growing greatly. Many people continue to venerate him and extol him for his priestly virtues.
Father Galvan was the first of the 25 martyrs that were beatified. He was the first in the persecution, the early days of the persecution, before Cayas took over.
We say, if the walls could talk, I feel these walls screaming out, let my people go. And now we have another exodus. With the blood of these priests, the sea of evil will open up and our people will be freed once more, because I believe that the lives of these martyrs are going to bring so many vocations into the priesthood, not only in Mexico as we see it, but in the United States, all over the world.
And there is a new cry, a new battle cry, a new slogan, Viva Cristo Rey.
Can you say that with us?
Viva Cristo Rey.
Long live Christ the King.
Program you have just